Said it?
Yes.
So A union B union C is a set of elements which belong to either B or C or both, or A, or to A as well as B union, B or C. So set of elements which belong to B or A or C, or to B and C, or to A and B and C. This is what is meant by here. Okay. Now, are these elements any different? So think of any element which belongs to this set. Think of any element which belongs to this set, this collection. Then it means that this element belongs to either A or B or C. Right? Or ABC. Right? Or BC. Sure? Now, what is this collection of elements? This is a collection of elements which belongs to either A or B or C. Right, it's a collection of elements belongs to either A or B or C, or it belongs to A or B or and to C. Right? So you see the same set of elements here. You see that the two set of elements are identical. Yeah? You see the two set of elements are identical. You're not seeing that. Think more. Think harder. Help me put this in words properly. Help me to make this more transparent, yeah?
So we can maybe start by saying that X is an element that belongs to B union C. Therefore, it belongs to B or C or both. And then we can say that if X belongs to A union B, A union BC as well, then it belongs to all three. Basically, what you're proving. Then we can say that, assume that there is a Y which belongs to A union B. And if it belongs to A union B union C, then it belongs to all three as well. Therefore, X and Y are similar. Therefore, the two.
Okay, so let's just make this more clear. When did we say that two sets are equal, A and B? Whenever an element belongs to A, it belongs to B, and whenever it belongs to B, it belongs to A. So, if we are claiming that these two collections are identical, we should be able to say that whenever an element belongs to this, it must belong to this. If it belongs to this, it must belong to this. So let's first start checking whether it's possible for an element to belong to this collection, but not to this collection. Let's start by looking for such elements. Suppose such an element exists. Suppose you have Y which belongs to, yeah? So what does this mean? This means that Y, either Y belongs to A, right? Or Y belongs to B, or Y belongs to C, or, yeah, so that's what it really means, right? Okay, Y either belongs to A or B or to C. Sure? Now, is it possible for this Y to be not in this connection? Because what is this a collection of? This is a collection of elements which are common to A, B and C. So this Y either has to belong to A or to B or to C. And therefore this Y must belong to either A or B or C. So you can't have a Y which is in this collection but not in this collection. Can you think of the vice versa? Can you think of some Y which belongs to this collection but not to this collection? Is it possible? Because if something belongs to this collection, it either belongs to A or to B or to C. In which case, it is not possible that it does not belong to this collection by definition. Right? Sure? So therefore, the two collections are identical. Okay? The two collections are identical. Right? And this is generally true for any number of sets, not only three. You can think of a large number of sets, possibly infinitely many sets, for which this property will hold. Okay? Sure? Everybody is getting this? Everybody sees the point here? More than the point, think of the, I hope you are understanding the way in which we are thinking about sets. We have defined equality of sets, so when we are checking for this theorem, we have to then show when we are saying they are equal. Disproving this would mean that you have some element here which is not an element here. And if there is some element here which is not an element here. If you can show that there don't exist any such elements, then we will be saying that the two collections are equal. Okay? Right. So now, let me introduce you. So that's how we prove theorems.
So, why isn't that we write X belongs to A, B, C,
etc.? See, because A, as long as I've said X belongs to either A or B, then actually I don't need to say both, no? Yeah? Obviously there could be some X's which belong to both. But as long as I'm checking whether it either belongs to A or to B, I'm fine enough. A, so can you speak a little bit louder? Just like I can't hear you, you can't hear me. The same distance are you. Right? So what he's saying is bracket? Where? Bracket here or here? Can we prove this? Thank you for asking a very nice question. So prove karo it. Is the same? You see the point that they're the same? Yeah? And you do you really see the connection of this with the following? You see the connection with this? Doesn't really depend how you add things up. The sequence of adding doesn't matter. Right? Sure? Okay? So now let me introduce to you another object. Okay? Think of a set A, set B. Think of the set of elements which belong. Now when we thought of union, we thought set of elements which belong to either A or B. Yeah? Now think of elements which belong to A and B. Think of elements which belong to A and B, which is different from A or B. So how do you represent these elements? You say those are represented by A intersection B. Okay? So there are, if X belongs to A and X belongs to B, implies X belongs to A intersection B. Okay? Sometimes there might be no elements which are common to A and B. In which case we say that A intersection B is the empty set. The empty set is not a set containing zero. It's a set which has no elements. Yeah, for example, if I say that, say, X is a set of cats, animals which are cats, and Y is a set of animals which are parrots, then there cannot be an animal which is a cat and a parrot at the same time. Right? So it's illogical to ask that question, right? So X A intersection B will be empty. Sure? Okay, so A intersection B is empty. Such sets are called disjoint sets. Sets where A and B intersection is an empty set are said to be disjoint sets. Can you give me an example of a disjoint set? odd and even numbers. Let A be the set of odd numbers, let B be the set of even numbers. There cannot be a number which is odd and even at the same time. So A intersection B is an empty set, right? So A and B are disjoint sets. Okay, A and B are disjoint sets. Okay? And again, remember, here also, if the next theorem that you're going to use, you must keep a tag number, because this is going to be theorem 1, theorem 2, and like that we'll go on till the last semester. Right, end of the semester. So at the end of the semester, whatever theorem you have, will follow sequentially from this. Right? So, A is this true? Is this true or is this not true? Not true? True or not true? What is A intersection B? Set of elements which belong to A and B. What is A intersection B intersection C? Set of elements which belong to A intersection B. Intersection C meaning set of elements belong to A and B and C. So this is set of elements which belong to all the three sets. What is A intersection C? Set of elements belong to A and C and those which belong to B as well. So this is again set of elements which belong to A, B and C. So both of them are identical. Both of them are identical. Okay? Right. Now, I'm going to ask you theorem 3. Tell me, what is A union B intersection C? Argue this. Is this true? Is this true or is this not true? A union B intersection C is A intersection C union B intersection C. Is this true or is this not true? True? True?
Yes.
Prove that. When you say something is true, the onus of proving it is on you. I'm not saying it. This is a game. You're playing a game. These are all mental games. Those who like to exercise their minds should be in the class. So why is it true? What is this? This set of elements which are either in A or B but are in C as well. These are elements which are either in A or B but are in C. Right? So this set of elements which are either in A or C or in A and C or in B and C. Yeah? But we need to do a more formal proof. So how will you go about that? Suppose X belongs to A union B intersection C. right? Then what does it mean? So it means X belongs to A union B and C. Right? What does it mean that X belongs to A or B and C? Which means X belongs to A and C or X belongs to B and C. But this statement is nothing but this statement here. Right? So there are actually two different ways of looking at the same system. Now the properties that we have studied so far are called distributive and associative properties. It's your homework to find out which of these properties are distributive properties and which of these properties are called associative properties. Right? Which of these properties are called distributive properties and which of these properties are called associative properties is homework that you have to do at home. Right? Which is homework that you have to do at home. So, yeah? Any doubts about this? How to argue about this? You've seen how we are arguing, right? Sure? Yes? Yeah. See, if X belongs to A union B and C, right? Okay? So, A union B intersection C. So, X belongs to A union B and C, this statement means. But this statement then means that X belongs to A or B and C. Which means that X belongs to either A and C or B and C. Which means that X belongs to A and C or B and C. But what is A and C? A intersection C. What is B and C? B intersection C. And what is the or? The union. What is the or? The union. Clear? Sure? We can do all these things without writing any examples on board. We don't need to. So two things I will not do and I will not tolerate. I will not tolerate any Venn diagrams. You know those ball circles, you draw one circle overlapping another and tell me this is black color part is A and blue color part is B and the A and the green color part which is common to both is intersection, which is okay in school, but now we have to think of more abstract ways of theorizing. Yeah? We have to think of more abstract ways because those are the core skills that we are trying to get. As you have seen, my micro class would have been very abstract. Your preference orderings and, you know, consumption bundles and sets of consumption bundles and everything. Right? So it's important that we develop the habits of thinking correctly, rigorously about abstract entities. That is why we are here, and that's why we teach you any mathematical economics at all. Right? Okay? It might seem far-fetched and away from the real world, but these are some critical skills that you need to develop in order to understand the real world better. Okay? And these are steps to actually help you on the way to develop those skills. Right? This is an economics course is different from a management course. In a management course, it's not applied. So the first class you have to tell them how to use that. Right? But because generally the theoretically strong basis in there, managers are not really economists. They can apply certain tools, but they're not, it's not their job to think about the world using economic tools. That's what economists have to do. And that's why economists have different jobs compared to managers. Yeah? And those are the skills that we are now trying to learn. If I was teaching a management class, I would not teach this. I would teach something else which they can apply, go out and apply directly in the real world. But when you train yourself as an economist, you are not going to do that. You are going to learn to ask fundamentally different questions from the kind of questions which managers ask. Yeah? And therefore, our training has to be different. And therefore, in the mathematical economics class, we will immediately not have many applications. Only later, when an appropriate set of tools is there with you, I will ask you to solve real-world problems. But not right away. Okay? Right, so this might all seem abstract and away from the real world, but it isn't. Without that, you really can't get into the real world to solve real world problems. Yeah? And that's why this training. Sure? Is it okay? Now, think of A. And think of A as a subset of B. Right? A complement is a collection which has the property that if X belongs to A complement, implies X does not belong to A. Yeah? Right? So what is the complement of odd numbers? What is the complement of odd integers? What is the complement of odd integers? Please say. Be a little bit louder. The complement of odd integers, she says, is even integers and zero. Any more doubts on this? Any answer? Any other answers to this? Even fractions. Fractions, right? Because are fractions even integers? Is a fraction an even integer? No. So the set of even integers, will it contain a fraction? No. Right? Therefore, the set of integers, set of even integers, so the fractions will lie in the complement of the set of even integers. Yeah? So if you think of male cats, what are the complements of male cats? Do crows belong to the complementary set of male cats? Yes, because a crow is not a male cat. Right? Sure? So anything that is not an element of this set is a complement. Anything that's not an element of this set is a complement. Right? Whereas, we also think of a symmetric difference. Okay, we think of a set difference. Okay? The idea of a set difference, essentially, is the following. Okay? The idea of a set difference, essentially, is the... Even if I got a good example of a set difference. Okay? Relative difference, right? Relative difference. So, if you have A with a subset of B, okay, then the set of elements which belong to B but not to A are written as B minus A. Right? So what is B minus A? B minus A contains, so if X belongs to B minus A, it implies that X belongs to B and X does not belong to A. Right? So now, let's now get her answer back and let's look at the difference between the two. If you think of the set of all integers, if the set of negative integers is a subset of the set of all integers, you call it A, then the relative difference between B and A, that is the relative difference between the set of all integers and the set of negative integers, is those integers which belong to the set of all integers but do not belong to the set of negative integers, that is the set of positive integers. So if you think of male cats and female cats, if you think of the set of cats, the symmetric difference between the set of cats and the set of tomcats is the set of female cats. But the simple complement of the set of tomcats is crows, frogs, everything else, even me. Right? So you see the difference between a complement and a symmetric difference? Every sees the difference between a complement and a symmetric difference. Sure? सबको समझा है? Way back in the remote reaches of this class, yeah, wherever my voice might not be reaching, have you still followed what I've said? Sure? Yes. You see, we talked about the complement of a set. The complement of the set is simply the set of elements which do not belong to that set. Whereas, when we think of a relative difference, let A be a subset of B, think of all elements which belong to B but not to A, then the relative difference B and A is given by these elements which belong to B but not to A. So, if you think of the set of all cats, and to think of tomcats as a subset of all cats, then the symmetric difference between the set of all cats and tomcats is cats which are not tomcats, which are female cats. But if you look at simply the complement of tomcats, complement of all animals which are not tomcats, if you think of this defined set of all elements of animals which are not tomcats, then even fish will come into that because they are not tomcats. If you think of just the complement of tomcats, and anything that cannot be classified as a tomcat, including the chalk and the camera and the desk, will belong to this complement. Right? So two things have to be, so therefore there is a difference. So something is a complement only with respect to the definition of a larger set. The set of complements only comes with respect to the definition of a larger set. But the idea of a relative difference is a much more precise idea. Right, it is B minus A, set of all elements which belong to B but not to A. Right? Okay. So let me give you a